thank you all for joining us on the What Can You Do Right Now weekly workshop, where we are helping you get relevant, practical information that you can apply in your business today. Last week, we had Deshante Freeman of Freeman Human Resource Management, who talked about how we can return to work safely for businesses that have been closed and are maybe trying to reopen or bring employees back into the office. So if you missed that, we have our YouTube channel where that is shared. So we would be happy to share that with you. Today, we have Ryan McIntyre, a founding partner at McIntyre Anderson, a law firm that helps business owners in their day-to-day operations with all of the legal things. So Ryan has been an attorney for over 10 years. He is also a business owner himself, and is in his career, he has represented small businesses up to Fortune 500 companies. So Ryan is going to run us through contractors versus employees in the context of AB5. So with that, I'm going to hand it off to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Anna, and thank you, Em, for joining this session today. As Anna mentioned, we're going to be talking about AB5 today because we've seen a lot of press about AB5 recently, and the new provisions just went into effect at the beginning of July. So it seems very apropos to be talking about this, but this actually, AB5 touches on a general question that a lot of my clients have, and that is just in general, when do we treat the workers as employees versus independent contractors? And a lot of my clients have a lot of questions around this, and it's a confusing area, but it's also an important area to address and get right, because there are huge consequences for any kind of misclassification. And it goes both ways. It's not just if you incorrectly classify as an independent contractor. If you independently classify as an employee, there's benefits and opportunities that you miss out in that direction too. So it really is something that I think a lot of small businesses would gain benefit from getting greater understanding about it, and also starting to process through what are the ramifications of making one decision one way versus or another way. So with that, I'd like to cover four basic things to just in general give an overview of a contractor versus an employee, and then dig into a little bit of the benefits versus the risks with however that worker is classified, and then specifically do a deep dive into AB5 once we've started answering the questions of why is this even important for business owners. And then finally, to touch off with the theme that we have in this session, what can you do right now? There's a lot of things that business owners and employers can do to best establish their relationship with their workers and do things to mitigate the risk and protect themselves going forward, as well as understanding when is the that important time that you pull the trigger and actually talk to an attorney about these types of things. So real quick, before getting into things any further, I just want to have a brief disclaimer that this isn't specific legal advice. This is general information that you can use for general purposes. I can't address any specific questions particular to your situation. And the purpose of this isn't to create an attorney-client relationship. It's more just to help you have general information about what the current state of the law is, to help guide when you might want to actually engage an attorney. And how you make your decisions with your business. Of course, I'm a lawyer, so I have to throw that in there. So with that, whenever a company pays a worker for some kind of labor or service, what is the nature of that relationship? We all instinctively recognize that there's some kind of relationship there, and we kind of have an instinctive sense that maybe they're an employee, or that maybe there's a contractor, or maybe there's an agent. It can get kind of fuzzy. But the heart of this law is coming up with the dividing characteristic that determines one versus the other. And the law, for all intents and purposes, relevant for our discussion here, recognizes two options. You're either an employee or you're a contractor. And so then the key question is, how do you tell the difference? And that is going to be the subject of our conversation here. There's a number of different laws that touch on how to characterize, and AB5 is just one of many of the different laws that have impact here. So why does that matter? Why does it matter to be able to tell the difference? Well, there's several pragmatic considerations. if you with an independent contractor, you can have specialized personnel that focus on a particular problem. Like think of lawyers, for example, or accountants or plumbers or people that have particular expertise that you in your business, you don't want to actually have to, you know, build out your business to have that expertise. You can then hire somebody else outside of the business to have that expertise. You also have greater flexibility rather than investing in the HR and employee infrastructure. You can just hire a couple of contractors to do the work exploratory within that region for you. Also, you can limit the scope of the engagement rather than having an employee, which brings in the whole box of rights and obligations and relationships with that. You can contractually strictly limit the relationship that you have with that worker. You also get a lot of cost savings. There's a number of taxes that you can avoid that don't apply to independent contractors. You don't have to worry about making sure that your fringe benefits go to this worker. And administering employees has, I'm sure, you're a significant overhead, whereas that overhead is largely reduced for independent contractors. And also you reduce your liability exposure. There's a lot of employee protection laws that are out there that do not apply for independent contractors. Now, that's not all liability. You'll never eliminate all liability exposure when you have workers involved, but the number of laws and the magnitude of the laws is significantly lesser when you're in a relationship with an independent contractor as opposed to an employee. So those are just some of the main pragmatic and business driving considerations for why you want to have an independent contractor. But that's not, the benefits don't all flow one way. Employees have a lot of benefits as well. For example, the key consideration is you have much greater control over the employee and how they conduct the work that you are requesting. With an independent contractor, since you're at a distant relationship with them, you have much less say in how the work is performed, what time that they're doing the work, the caliber of the performance, and the ways that you can ultimately terminate or affect the relationship if the work isn't up to your particular standards, which leads into the termination at will. The labor code provides a presumption that any employment is at will. Independent contractors, you don't get that benefit. If the contract itself is going to specify what the termination standard is, and it's typically for cause or limited to a number of specifically defined criteria. So if you're not happy with the way that the work is being performed, you can be in a tight space with how you want to terminate or end that relationship. With employees, also you have much more stability with the relationship. Your employees are dependent upon you for their income, for their livelihood. They're dedicating a significant portion of their time for it, and that lends itself to a much greater stability and length to that relationship. And finally, there's no risk of misclassification that points towards the employee sides of things. So the laws that will penalize employers for misclassification, they don't go. That's only for if you call an employee an independent contractor. If you end up calling an independent contractor an employee, there's a whole bunch of benefits that go that way. The government gets their tax, so they're much less concerned with penalizing that. And speaking of those misclassification risks, there are a lot of potential downsides for the misclassification. You can get hit with back taxes, unpaid wages, civil penalties. And you can get audited and have a regular audit, recurring audit. There's a lot of structure in place to essentially punish employers who do not classify their employees as employees. And I think one of the worst things is that there's no good faith mistake excuse available to the employers. So you can't say, oh, I didn't know, or I did my best efforts, but this was just a mistake on our side. You'll still get penalized. Now, the penalties might not be as bad. There's even some criminal penalties if you intentionally misclassify and mislead. But even if it's a good faith, there still is going to be some penalization if the government ultimately finds that you did misclassify. So all that goes to encouragement to make sure that you pay attention to the classification process correctly. So how does this even come up? How does that misclassification even get exposed? And actually, there's a lot of ways that that can surface. If you sever a relationship with an independent contractor and then they file an unemployment benefit claim, that is one way that the state could start investigating the character of the relationship. Another one would be if somebody files a workers' comp claim because they got injured while they were performing on the contract. Also, harassment claims with the different government agencies that are in charge of policing harassment. If they claim that they're unemployed, then they're going to start investigating the nature of that relationship. There's also a number of lawsuits that can be brought. You know, a wrongful termination isn't available for independent contractors, but it is available for employees. So you might get sued if they are dissatisfied with the nature of the termination. And finally, there's tax audits. If you're not paying your unemployment insurance or your payroll taxes as the government would expect, and they notice that you have a large number of contractors, or they're suspicious about the 1099s that are associated with your account, they might start doing their own audit and investigating the nature of that relationship. So that's just some of the many ways that this characterization can suddenly become an issue. And it's kind of important to pay attention to these types of factors, because no relationship begins thinking it's going to end with unemployment claims or harassment lawsuits or anything of that sort. You know, relationships typically begin on a very positive footing, but it's important to think about how the relationship could ultimately sour, or what might happen if the business changes ownership or structures happen differently, or, you know, if there's a pandemic that suddenly erupts and causes you to rethink everything. So even though we don't like to think about the negative side of things, about how relationships could evolve or unfortunately end in nasty ways, it's important to keep that in mind as you're setting the relationship up. Just if you want to, in the best as a the best way to protect your business, think about the types of ways that these things could ultimately unfold. So that now we know that it's relatively important to get this question right. Unfortunately, the question of how to tell the difference doesn't have a good straightforward answer. There's no one-size-fits-all test. Instead, the analysis of whether it's an employee or a contractor depends on the relevant law or the issue that's at play. So for example, with tax withholding, the question of is this person an employee or not is a different analysis than if in case of workers' compensation or unemployment benefits. So that leaves the business owner in a tricky situation, because you can't possibly expect to become a master in employment independent contractor law, especially because it's always changing and the rules are so varied. So instead, I'm going to have to start going over some of the best practices that you can have around just how do you engage with the complexities of the law. And specifically here, I'm going to walk you through AB5, the new law that I'm sure a lot of you have heard about. Because AB5 is both very prominent in the recent press. It's changed California law so that it ends up becoming one of the tests that you're going to be, or standards that you're going to be hitting the most frequently, as well as it's a the principles that guide the analysis are generally applicable to the other areas, even though each one has its own unique little spin. So with that, I'm going to start deep diving into AB5 here. And AB5 basically, at its core, says to tell the difference between a contractor or an employee, you either apply the ABC test, and we'll get into that one, or the economic realities test, or some other test. And these are tests to determine the character of the relationship. And the broadest application will end up being the first two items there. So AB5. Like I said, the characterization law depends upon the particular domain that's at play. AB5 covers the five that you see listed right there. The California wage orders is the body of law that dictates, you know, how much you have to pay particular employees, when are they salaried, when are they exempt, you know, what is overtime pay for this, what is holiday pay, et cetera. That these wage orders is the huge body of law that governs those types of payment requirements. The labor code is California's general employment law. So things such as the employment at will presumption show up in there. Unemployment insurance code is the is a specific body that covers unemployment insurance, obviously, as well as workers' compensation speaks for itself. And then Private Attorney General Act is the act that lets private citizens sue as though they were essentially the state of California. So certain laws that give the right to the Attorney General to bring a lawsuit against a company, those apply to private individuals as well. So in other words, it broadens the scope of things which an employee could sue an employer for. And by AB5 making changes in this domain, and now it effectively broadens the scope of which a private individual could bring a lawsuit. AB5 does not cover federal laws or California withholding tax or tort laws or anything else that's not explicitly covered. So again, that goes back to one of the nuances in this area, that each domain has its own particular test that will apply. So with having that broad area carved out, the first test that AB5 covers is this ABC test. And this is going to be the default test. So if you have a question about whether or not it's an employee or an independent contractor, this is going to be the first one that would apply in the situation. And that is this ABC test, which deceptively makes it seem easy. It's easy as ABC. We're going to find quickly that it's not quite that case. But at the high level, the worker is presumed to be an employee unless the company shows all three of those factors there, that the worker is free from the company's control, that the worker's services are outside of the company's primary business, and that the worker engages regularly in the trade that the worker is hired for, independent from the company. So diving into each of those a little bit more, thanks for going back there. The worker free from the company's control means that think about how you control an employee. You tell them when to show up, how to perform their work, when to make sure when the work needs to be completed, what is their promotion. There's a high level of control about how that employers have with their employees. The ABC's tests will not be, or how should I say, the if a company can't, if the company shows that they have too much control over this particular individual, then the test will not be satisfied for that particular worker. Worker services lying outside of the company's primary business, that's a new factor that was introduced by AB5 that actually really broadens the scope here. And this is gonna be one that there's a lot of ambiguity around, but also there's gonna be interesting issues in this area, because worker services lie outside of the company's primary business instinctively might make sense. The example used was a retail store owner that hires a plumber. In that case, the plumber is performing services outside of the retail store's business, but it gets a little tricky when you actually start thinking about other situations. What about a plumbing store that hired a plumber? Probably wouldn't qualify there, but what about a company that hires a marketer? All businesses do perform marketing services, and it's gonna be a little trickier to tell in that situation. Is that an independent contractor, or is that an employee? Because all businesses do marketing, and the standard isn't that the work lies outside of the services that are sold to customers, the products that are sold. It just instead has this broad category of the outside of the company's primary business, which it remains to be seen ultimately how that gets defined. But you can expect that the government is going to be pushing for a broader interpretation that can lead into some ambiguous situations for employers. And then the final test is that, I jumped ahead on a slide there. The final one with the worker engaging in the particular trade, that's gonna pose an issue about what happens if a contractor has only one or two customers, or what if it's somebody who just wants to do part-time work on the side. That could impact the types of contractors that you want to work with. And then notably absent from this list, well, two things first to say. One is there's a presumption that applies to employers. So the burden is on the employer to show that all of these three things actually apply. So all the worker has to do is file the claim, and then once the claim comes and impacts the employer, then it's up to the employer to actually affirmatively prove each of these three items, which can be, you know, onerous and tricky. It's very good to be mindful of those things when you're engaging your relationships with your contractors. Second thing is that there are a number of notable items that are absent from this. There's no discussion of full-time or part-time, no mention of the duration of the relationship. There's no mention of probationary periods. And a couple of things that I thought of later after doing the slide was that there's no notion of a subcontractor called out specifically, and there's no notion of the language in the contract. So even though the contract that you have with the independent contractor says that we're having a contractor relationship, that's not going to fly in the face of this particular test. I skipped ahead there already and talked about how it's deceptively complicated, but the good news, or a little bit of good news, is that there's a number of exceptions to the ABC test. And exception just means that a different test applies. It doesn't mean that we're out of the woods altogether and that this particular worker is not an employee. It just means that a different and typically lesser standard is actually going to apply. There are occupational exceptions. So there's a big laundry list of particular occupations that the ABC test does not apply to, such as attorneys, accountants. There are exceptions for specific industries and a bunch of qualifications around when those particular exceptions would apply, like freelance writers, but only for 35 submissions. There are general professional services, quote unquote, exceptions, and there's also business to business exceptions. I'm not gonna go into those because they're very particular and explicitly defined, but just serves to know that there's actually, even though the ABC test is deceptively simple, there's also a big carve out for that with a bunch of different professions that are specifically identified. Now, the goal of the having these exceptions was to lessen the impact of AB5, but it remains to be seen if the impact actually will play out. There's also a lot of notable omissions from those exceptions. Healthcare professionals, for example, like nurses and hospital equipment technicians. Gig workers are accepted, and that was actually part of the intent around AB5 was that, you know, I'm sure you heard about Uber and Lyft drivers or DoorDash deliverers or things like that, the state trying to capture them as employees of the services. Truck drivers, housekeepers, health aides, clergy, entertainment professionals, they're not carved out from this. So that could have dramatic impact on any employer that interacts with any of these service providers. So if you do end up landing within the exceptions list, likely the economics realities test is going to be the one that applies. And basically that one focuses primarily on the degree of control that the employer has on the worker. There's a number of additional secondary factors, such as whether or not the contract actually specifies the nature of the relationship, or whether or not the worker has their own business, whether or not the worker has a number of other clients. Where is the risk of failure? Can the contractor go out of business? A lot of those factors aren't included in the ABC test. It's more of a holistic picture assessment, with the primary controlling factor being the amount of control that you have over the person that's performing those, or that the employer has over the worker that's performing those services. So with all that being said, and with that confusing morass, what can you do right now? So the number one thing that you can do is you can assess and just get into a body of assessment whenever you interact with new workers or with your current workforce. Start looking, does this worker have their own business with their own customers, marketing, and their own risk of failure? Can they go, in essence, can they go out of business? What kind of control do you have over this particular worker? Is it that they'll produce something for you and you can give them some feedback and send it back to them and then they can produce it? Or do you have a lot more of particular control over when they're gonna be, where they're gonna be, how they're gonna be when they're there? Do they have to smile all the time? You know, it depends on how much particular control that you have over them. Start thinking about once it starts, once you start getting suspicious of how much control, be mindful that you might be hitting a situation where you have a you might have an employee in that relationship. How close is the worker services to the work that your business conducts? Not just products or services that the business sells, although that's an important part of it, but in general, how much does the how close is it to the type of general business operations that you have in-house? The next thing that you can do is review your current relationships. Examine the current relationships, especially considering the ABC test and the new framework that applies. If you see some that clearly you're not going to be able to survive on one of those tests, start thinking, is there an exception that applies, and is there a different relationship, or is this something that we could have an issue here? And adjust your risk appetite in the face of the greater expansion of employment classification. So thanks to AB5, more contractors are going to be classified as employees now, and that means that there's going to be greater risk for employers to possibly get hit with liability based upon that expanded classification, as well as adjust your risk appetite in light of the fact that adjust your risk appetite in light of the ambiguity that's presented with the statute, where I mentioned the two of the latter factors in the ABC test. There's a lot of confusion as to ultimately how those will be applied. Use that as part of your risk appetite analysis for understanding and making judgment calls about the relationships that you have with your workers. Talk with an attorney if you have any questions. Anywhere that there is a gray area, it would behoove you to speak with an attorney that has expertise in this area to gauge, is this actually something that we need to worry about? Is this something that we need to do something different about? Or are we probably safe here? You shouldn't expect to become an expert on independent contractor versus employee classification. There's a number of highly qualified attorneys that can help you out on this matter. Please don't take the risk upon yourself by putting that on your plate. Instead, rely on a trusted advisor to be able that has expertise in this arena, especially since it's rapidly evolving. It is very confusing. You want somebody that knows the ins and outs of this to be able to help you on this. And also make sure you talk to an attorney before you actually, if you make any transition. If you see an independent contractor and you think, oh, they're an employee, let's make that transition quick, you want to do that carefully. You don't want to trigger an investigation or claims that wouldn't have arisen if you didn't rock the boat there. So it's definitely something to be mindful of. Adapt your behavior in light of these changes. You want to be able to make sure that your new relationships clearly satisfy the ABC test if that's what applies. So update your agreements. Make sure that you're considering those factors when you're hiring new talent, and include that in the vetting process. And also start thinking about possibly expanding to staffing agencies, although that has its own area of risk. So probably want to talk to an attorney before you rely exclusively on that as an alternative method. And then finally, monitor. This is a rapidly changing space. So make sure that you're periodically checking things as things change. There's lots of challenges to the law. There's lots of lawsuits that are flying both ways, and courts really have yet to weigh in. So there's going to be a lot of movement in this space. So check in every 6 months, every year to see how the landscape has changed. And with that, I am open for any questions.
Well, since this ended up being quite a bit of content, I think we are actually at time, but I wanted to make sure, Ryan, that you had enough time to kind of go through that, because it is so nuanced. There is so much information, and my takeaway was talk to a lawyer. So thank you so much again for that, for all of your knowledge and expertise, and being willing to share it with us. If you would like to reach out to a lawyer, for example, this lawyer, here is his contact information, and we will also share that in the follow-up email. And then as businesses are starting to kind of open up, we're not all open, but we're starting to get back to businessing. We want to continue sharing resources, but we have decided to move this to a bi-monthly workshop rather than weekly. So the next workshop will be July 23rd. And then going forward after that, it will be the first and third Thursday of the month. On July 23rd, we will have Michael Dane, owner of Michael Dane Web Design, talking to us about websites and email marketing. So we hope you can join us then and hope you guys all have a great week. Thanks again, Ryan.
Thank you very much. Pleasure being here.